Great, thank you. And that was a great segue, actually, into the next session. I'm going to ask the people who are speaking on the WIPP panel to come on up, and so we can start. And I want to also introduce Mark Frei, who's going to be the moderator of the session. He's now with Longenecker, and he's also one of the key people at EFCOG, you know, somebody who helps run the projects and run the program at EFCOG. But he's also been an important partner for us as we move forward. A lot of you remember him as one of the former budget guys in EM, and he's somebody who we still go to for a lot of that information. So with that, I'm going to hand it over to Mark. Thanks, Mark.
Thank you, Seth. So this is the session on resuming operations at the Waste Isolation Pilot Plant, the National TRU Program. I think the conversation just between Chuck Bernhardt and the acting undersecretary certainly sets us up very well. We have five speakers, so they each get about 10 minutes, I believe, and leave room for questions. Look, I'm really honored to be moderating this session on getting WIPP in the National TRU Program back in business. When I think back on WIPP's history and its future, near term and longer term, one word came to mind when I was thinking about today, and that was the word hurdle. The first hurdle was getting Congress together back in the late 70s to figure out how to get WIPP's mission defined, defense, non-defense, the regulatory framework. So in 1979, we had construction authorization to build the facility. That was the first hurdle. The next hurdle was with construction done in the late 1980s, Admiral Watkins had a problem, then Secretary of Energy. And that was Rocky was still producing plutonium pits. He had nowhere to send the mixed waste. Idaho had closed its borders. So he picked on me and said, you have 10 weeks to get WIPP open. Well, after 10 years of legal battles, and enactment of the WIPP Land Withdrawal Act and meeting all those prerequisites, we got to ship the first waste out of Los Alamos, ironically, back on March 26th, about 4 a.m. in the morning in 1999. So it was a 10-year hurdle. So now, after 15 years of really successful operations from 1999 forward, the next hurdle, of course, is to overcome the underground fire and the rad release incident last February, and getting WIPP reopened again. So DOE, working with its contractor and the New Mexico Environment Department, is making progress in getting it open, although some of us would like to see it happen just a little bit faster. So we're going to clear that hurdle, I'm sure, in the very near term, as you've heard from Mr. Klaus. But what's the next hurdle beyond that? Is there another hurdle? Well, look, I was at the Rad Waste Summit last month. We heard a lot about Yucca Mountain and greater than Class C waste disposal. You heard about DOE spent nuclear fuel disposal, commercial spent fuel disposal, defense high-level waste. Discussion was all Yucca Mountain. And I would ask you to think about perhaps WIPP should be in that equation as well in that conversation. If you look back to the Nuclear Waste Policy Act, it envisioned two repositories for equity's sake, for the stakeholders and politically. DOE's own record of decision on low-level waste and mixed low-level waste that we issued around 1995 or 6 selected two sites, Hanford and Nevada, for equity. So perhaps there's room in the conversation for both Yucca Mountain and WIPP in terms of equity to finally address high-level waste and spent fuel disposal. So I would encourage our speakers today and all the DOE folks in the audience to think about that next hurdle after we get WIPP open. So meanwhile, let's talk about today where we are in this first near-term hurdle, which is opening WIPP. So our first speaker, Frank Marcinowski, we used to work together back in the day, who has been the Deputy Assistant Secretary on Waste Management, now is the Acting Associate Principal Deputy Assistant Secretary. The decoder ring would say EM 2.1, I believe. He will address us first. So Frank, take it away.
All right, thanks, Mark, and good afternoon, everybody. I've I'm going to run through and give you an overview of where I see us at with the RIP recovery operations right now. And I'm actually encouraged by what's going on out at WIPP. I've been spending a lot of time out at the facility over the past few months, and there's noticeable progress that we're seeing at the site. Granted, you know, a couple of months ago we announced that our original target date of March of next year was unachievable. But you got to remember when that schedule was put together. I mean, that was last September. We had limited knowledge of what was needed in order to bring the facility back to recovery. We've now got a new performance management baseline that we received from the contractor that actually integrates the base and recovery operations, and we're reviewing that right now. You know, we didn't announce a revision to the opening date because we wanted to ensure ourselves that we had a fair degree of confidence in whatever schedule we came out with to replace the March of 16 date. And so we're working our way through that process, and we're hoping that, you know, later this fall we'll be able to identify a new resumption date. But right now, like I say, they're making good progress in the underground, and we'll walk through some of that progress that's being made. These are the key recovery steps. I mean, these are the same ones that were announced in the recovery plan that we published last September, and we're working our way through these items. The documented safety analysis is making steady progress, and we're hoping to, you know, at least have a draft for that document submitted to the department later this calendar year. The underground restoration, they're making great strides in the underground restoration and bring the facility back to where it needs to be. You know, we hadn't been underground in about 9 months before we started sending workers underground and started some of the actual maintenance activities that need to occur in the underground. but they made significant strides since then. The mine stability, show pictures a little later on. We've now got a hybrid bolter that's in the underground. You know, ventilation is one of the key factors that is preventing us from operating multiple pieces of equipment at this point. And to date, we've only been able to operate one at a time, and that had been the bolter. But now we've got a bolter that runs on both diesel and electric, and so we're going to be able to, you know, run both these units simultaneously and speed up our efforts in that regard. The panel closures, you know, since the event, lands in Los Alamos had been identifying waste of similar characteristics that may pose a risk in the underground. And so now all that waste is behind closed panels. There's no waste that we feel is at risk in the underground anymore. And since we've closed those panels off. And I mentioned ventilation. We're working on two efforts, the interim and the supplemental ventilation. And they're both making progress right now. I'll talk a little bit more about that, you know, as further slides. here's a little more detail on the significant progress that's been made in terms of ground control, the bolting that's been done in the underground. You know, 85% of the catch-up bolting has been completed. The rad risk reduction, what they're doing is they're spraying water in the underground on the salt. The salt dissolves and then it recrystallizes, and thereby encapsulating a fair amount of the radioactivity. Where that is on a is where there's a higher risk areas, what they're doing is putting radish cloth down in the underground, putting another layer of salt on that and compacting it to further reduce the amount of radioactivity that can be reentrained in the atmosphere down there. The electronic restoration, the vehicle fire in the underground, the burning of the tires caused significant soot throughout the underground. Panel 6 and 7, I mentioned those already. Now, on the interim ventilation, as you may recall, when they were initially delivered to the site, there were some damages to both the fan units and well as the duct site. Those repairs have been completed, and most of those units are back on site. The fan units are back on site. I think 6 of the 10 ductwork shipments are also back on site. The installation is supplemental ventilation. That supplemental ventilation unit is actually installed now. There's a bulkhead that's been put in place. The supplemental ventilation unit has been bolted to that, and all they got to do is hook up the electrical for that right now. The hybrid bolter, I mentioned, that should be operational this week, I believe. I mentioned the new performance measurement baseline, which we're actually undergoing departmental review at this point in time. The AIB reports. As you all know, there's been 3 AIB reports. Those, we've got corrective actions in place for most of those. The caps are being implemented, and so we're making significant progress on that as well. Now the idea is that all the corrective actions will be implemented before we begin operations once again at the WIPP facility. Generator site impacts. You'll hear a little bit more about this from Jack, but the generator sites are continuing to process waste, basically Oak Ridge and Idaho. Los Alamos operations is stood down right now, but Jack will tell you about all the good work they're doing up there, and they're storing it on site, just waiting for WIPP to open again so we can bin shipments. Same thing going on at Oak Ridge, and so they've been able to identify sufficient storage at the generator sites that they can continue those operations. Now, we've not identified yet what the order would be or what the priority would be for shipping from the various sites once WIPP does resume operations. We expect that we'll be going through that exercise in the coming year, but right now it's just not, it's premature to do that. And some of the considerations that would go into this is that, we do have compliance milestones at some sites. We need to keep an eye on the storage capacity at these sites. And all that's going to factor into the sequencing of waste shipments once they do begin. Right now, we do have an inventory of waste that's sitting on the surface at the WIPP facility. You know, that would be the first that would need to be disposed of. We'll have to figure out the ordering of the other sites, in the coming months. We're also considering additional on-site storage at the WIPP facility. This is something that's under consideration right now. As part of the principles of agreement that we have with the state of New Mexico, they have agreed to consider a permit mod that would allow for on-site storage. So this would help us going forward with the operations at the site as, WIPP has future planned outages so that we can continue to waste shipments while those outages are ongoing. And then looking ahead, I mentioned the performance measurement baseline. And that's undergoing review. The interim supplemental ventilation, a very important aspect of moving forward and getting on with operations at the site. Before we do that, there's going to be operational readiness reviews. Although we don't have a schedule at this point, we're hoping that, sometime in the coming calendar year, we might be able to begin those operations again. But again, we're still reviewing the baseline, and hopefully we'll be able to come up with a new date in the coming months. I think that's That's what I have.
Thank you, Frank, for that update. We will take questions at the end after all five speakers are finished. Should have plenty of time for that. So our next speaker, is my pleasure to introduce a good friend of mine, Christine Gellis, the Associate Deputy Assistant Secretary for Waste Management at EM Headquarters. Recently returned from the great west frontier of Los Alamos, where she was EM's first, at least acting manager of the Los Alamos site office. Christine?
Good afternoon, everybody. Let's see. So how can we bring up slides? Do we know? Well, somebody comes up here and
Steve?
Helps turn my slides on, if they could.
Help us, Steve.
There are no slides? He's on it. Okay.
He's on it.
All right.
We can't see him, but he's on it.
So I know it's hot. Try to stay awake. I'll talk really fast sometimes. There'll be a test at the end. Let's see. I am just back from Los Alamos. I'm actually returning on Monday to be there for about another 2 weeks before I come back to do more complex wide waste management stuff like I've been doing for the last decade with Frank and many of you in this room. But I want to introduce you to somebody. He hasn't snuck out, has he? No, he's here. Everybody has asked me, who is this guy? Who is the new manager of EM Los Alamos? Doug Hinsey, could you stand up, please? You are. So in the generational relay race, we've passed the baton. He became the manager of EM Los Alamos on the 20th of September. So it was really my distinct pleasure to be out there and be working to stand up that office for the last 6 months, getting to meet many folks in the community and in the local industry. Thank you. And I'm really pleased to see that Kristen and others are here. So I think it's great. It is a pretty important part of our complex cleanup. I'm here today to talk to you about what's happening in true waste at Los Alamos since the WIPP outage. And as Frank alluded to, we have been paused in our processing of legacy true waste. We were going crazy there in the years leading up to the WIPP event because we were working towards what we called the 3706 campaign. We wanted to complete the removal of all the combustible true that we had identified at the start of fiscal year 2012 by June of 2014 as part of a framework agreement, and really trying to reduce the risk at the site because of the risks that that particular combustible waste form posed in the event of a wildland fire, which of course we know can happen up there. May 2014, we identified that the breached container in the WIPP underground had originated from Los Alamos National Laboratory, and we've been very much all about coming to understand what contributed to that packaging of incompatible materials and learning from it to make sure that we can share those lessons learned across the complex. More widely, any operations in Area G, which is our central waste management facility at Los Alamos, are really very limited pending some ongoing safety analyses to resolve some potential inadequate safety analyses questions, some open safety questions that have arisen not just because of that breached container, but just because of other operational circumstances at Los Alamos. We have to work very closely with the NNSA field office. They are the landlord office. They possess the Nuclear Safety Authority and Oversight Program. We, EM, are standing up our field office. We became operational in March of this year. We have 26 approved FTEs, and we have a plan to grow to over 40 over the course of the next 2 years. And as part of that growth is a nuclear safety office so that we can assume from NNSA, through delegations appropriately from headquarters, the nuclear safety oversight for all of these important operations. Our accident investigation board, the phase two on the WIPP event, did tell us a lot about Los Alamos. There were not a lot of surprises because we had been working so closely with the accident investigation board and the technical assistance team that was stood up of the five national laboratories to support them. But there were 22 judgments of need that we have to respond to, and I'll share a little bit of detail about those. We are safely managing the nitrate salts, that is the waste stream from which the breached container originated. They are in, they've been overpacked into these standard waste boxes, that's what you see there. They're inside a Permacon, inside a facility called Dome 375 in Area G in Technical Area 54, which is not that far from the public. It's actually less than a mile from the community of White Rock. So it's quite an important facility, and safety is of paramount concern for us. They are set with thermocouples. We're constantly monitoring them. There is a regulatorily approved isolation plan that guides how frequently we look at this and how frequently we share the data with New Mexico Environment Department. To provide some additional compensatory measures, some added confidence, we've also implemented over the summer some additional temperature control to keep them even lower temperature within this permacon. And so I could show you some pictures of that, but it's really just an added chiller unit outside the permacon. It chills the air before it goes in to make sure that we're trying to keep them below 60 degrees centigrade if we can. Fahrenheit, if we can. We're planning also for the future treatment of this waste stream, and there's a very detailed plan that's been developed. It's underpinned by some ongoing, very complex scientific experiments, and then we're really trying to embed that in a very rigorous project plan so that for the course of the next 2 years, we know exactly what we need to do with what is a very small population of our waste stream. There's just 60 containers of these nitrate salts that have been remediated and have the incompatible materials, that organic absorbent added to it, and then we have 29 unremediated nitrate salt containers above ground as well. And so for the next 2 years, that's really what we're focused on treating. We have a number of regulatory considerations that I want to share with you. The first is that in response to this event and the identification of the LANL container being part of the radiological release at WIPP, we did receive an administrative compliance order from New Mexico Environment Department. Some very competent technical teams were put together to formulate our corrective action plans. In May of 2015, we were very pleased that the department and the secretary of NMED were able to reach these principles of agreement. We hope settlement is on the horizon in the very near future. Meanwhile, we're working actively to implement these corrective action plans, and those plans have been integrated with the corrective actions that are required in response to the Accident Investigation Board as well. We also undertook a very extensive condition review that was communicated, I think, reported a bit in the press over the last several weeks. We submitted a written disclosure to NMED at the end of August that identified all of the potential regulatory noncompliances for the entire universe of legacy true waste that had been processed since 2005. An important consideration, the nitrate salts makes up less than 3% of all of the legacy waste that had been handled at Los Alamos. So we had to look at nearly 10,000 other parent containers and take a look at if we had similar procedural violations, if we had done absorption in the absence of the appropriate RCRA exemptions, et cetera. And so we tried to disclose all of the potentially bad news at the end of August. And again, we've learned a lot from that exercise and have integrated those insights into the corrective action plans as well. And I'm happy to say that NMED has actually joined our integrated project team as an observer. So they're actively involved as we're planning and conducting these experiments. They see firsthand what the results are. They have an active voice in the evaluation of the two treatment alternatives we're considering, which of course will be the basis of a regulatory permit application to them that they'll have to consider. So we're hoping that they're being embedded in this project planning will allow us to proceed as quickly as possible and minimize the hurdles that my friend Mark Frei referred to that we sometimes encounter. Just a little bit more detail about corrective action plans. As I mentioned, they are quite detailed. We have a joint federal corrective action plan between the EM Los Alamos Field Office and the NNSA Field Office that we signed jointly on September 15th and submitted to EM headquarters. EM headquarters will be concurring effectively on the EM-related actions. NNSA will be self-managing their own actions, and they are very parallel, and they are very comprehensive. And then LANS, of course, had to develop a corrective action plan, and we've seen and commented on several versions of that, and I expect the very final submission will happen, if not today, before the end of this week, and we'll submit that to EM headquarters as well for their acceptance. And, of course, our resumption of true waste processing, in particular the treatment of the nitrate salts, will only happen upon successful completion of a number of those specific actions in the corrective action plans. And this is my last slide. Just looking forward, I want your takeaway to be that we've really been thinking about this. We've learned a lot over the course of the last year and a half, and now EM Los Alamos, as a distinct field office, is well positioned to control and guide what's going to happen over the course of the next 2 years. So we've developed a technical basis, we have a baseline plan, we're safely managing these nitrate salts, and we're working towards their treatment, which will ultimately remedy what is the highest risk on site today. The preliminary plans have been developed, testing is ongoing. In the order, we're going to treat the remediated nitrate salts first because they are the highest risk, modify the system, treat the unremediated nitrate salts, again there's just 29 of those, and then potentially using the capabilities that we acquire over the next 2 years, we'll be processing other above grade TRU that's stored in Area G. We have about 1,300 cubic meters of waste stored there now. New Gen is really at a low pace of generation right now from the mission projects at Los Alamos, just because they're going through some restart and some rework of their plutonium facilities, which is a good thing because we don't have a lot of capacity within our safety bases to store. So it's really an iterative thing that we have to work closely with NNSA. I'm very, very pleased to report that we were able to reach a sole source justification or sole source negotiated contract with LANS, the M&O of the NNSA contract, so that they are going to be our EM prime contractor for the next up to 2 years to conduct this work, which is part of implementing the Secretary's vision of improving the safety management and oversight of the cleanup work at Los Alamos. So those are my comments. Thank you very, very much.
Thanks, Christine, for that update at Los Alamos. So next we're going to have a representative from DOE from the site that's shipped the most transuranic waste to WIPP, Idaho. Jack Zimmerman used to be the DUF 6 FPD. Now he's the deputy manager at the Idaho Ops Office. Talk about cleanup at Idaho and true waste. Jack?
Thank you, sir. Thanks, Mark. All right, thanks, Mark. Just to give a little bit of background about Idaho, and I know Mark already stole part of the thunder about being the largest shipper of transuranic waste to WIPP. There's a lot of good reasons for that. The majority of the transuranic waste that has been historically stored in Idaho did not come from Idaho. It was shipped to Idaho from other sites, primarily Rocky Flats, and that became a fairly significant political as well as legal issue in the state of Idaho. So we have a very rigid regulatory framework which governs how we approach the remediation and disposal of transuranic waste. Originally, there was about 65,000 cubic meters of transuranic waste that was stored above ground on pads that were ultimately covered by earthen berms, then ultimately a superstructure over that. And that was done fairly, I guess, late during the time frame where transuranic waste was being received at the site. Prior to that, transuranic waste was received at the site and actually was buried underground in unlined disposal cells. And so that waste is also part of the CERCLA process, is being exhumed and disposed of. And I'll show you a little bit of pictures here. There we go. As I said, Idaho has been the largest shipper of both contact-handled and remote-handled transuranic waste to WIPP. About 55,000 cubic meters of the Idaho Settlement Agreement waste, which, if you remember, was about 65,000 total, has been shipped to waste already or another appropriate facility if it turned out that it was actually low-level as opposed to transuranic. And if you look at the pictures on the bottom, the picture to your left, that shows you the above-ground storage area, transuranic storage area. That area is now covered by an enclosure, that contains any potential releases for the material. It is still very, highly hazardous. A lot of it is hands-on retrieval work. The drums in those areas have been stored outside for decades. So a lot of the drums that we're getting to now are some of the hardest material that's left to get to. Many of the drums are degraded, although they look largely intact. Some of them are. Some of them are just a shell that can kind of just collapse as you try to pick it up. So that creates a lot of potential physical as well as radiological hazards for that area. To the right, you'll see workers that are actually, they sort through the buried waste that we retrieve. So we only go after the targeted waste, which is the transuranic, basically transuranic and mixed waste, which ultimately gets repackaged for shipment to WIPP. Idaho did provide the first contact-handled shipment to WIPP, but also had the second remote-handled shipment to WIPP. We have our on-site, basically the only site that has an on-site certified true waste program. And we have provided services, both characterization and treatment, to other DOE sites, and ultimately maybe a future purpose for the mission once we complete processing Idaho waste. Okay, for the true waste operations, advanced mixed waste treatment plant, That is a facility which processes contact handled true, which primarily came from the above ground storage area. It also has a super compactor, which is able to compress the waste to save on volume and disposal volume. And it gets a significant volume reduction, and that may have a very important future mission for DOE going forward, because it's essentially a one-of-a-kind facility. Right now, we have about 706 shipments. That's about over 18,000 drums are currently in our backlog that we've already processed since WIPP is closed and is awaiting shipment once WIPP reopens. In the waste exhumation area, you saw the picture earlier, we process that waste that's exhumed, and again, that's also primarily all contact-handled waste. For remote-handled waste, although it is a significant part of our operations, the volume is very, very small, but the work is very complex. So we have to treat and repackage remote-handled waste. All that work is done inside of a hot cell, so it's a very limited as far as speed goes. But we have about 60 shipments that are currently in the backlog with remote-handled waste. Later this year, we should complete the processing of all the remote-handled waste that was part of the original Idaho settlement agreement. So as far as impacts goes, the immediate impact is on storage. So when the event occurred, we shifted the priorities primarily as much as possible to try to target some of the true waste drums that may have had lower activity, and once we get in and process them, could possibly have been mixed low-level waste. So we kind of put a focus on generating mixed low-level waste and looking for storage alternatives. Immediately commissioned a study. We've completed a conceptual design for an on-site storage facility on a modular basis, so if we need to add capacity, we can. We've also shared that design with the Carlsbad field office, so that could be an option that they may use down in Carlsbad. Then we worked with the state proactively. The state of Idaho has been a fairly good regulator to work with. They didn't really want us building new storage facilities on site that were just going to have to be torn down. So they worked with us to reconfigure storage capacity that we had on site so that we could store things denser, we could stack some items higher, and they're even going so far as discussing that we may actually put circular waste in a RCRA facility. That would be the ultimate goal when we get there. But right now, because we have been able to reconfigure storage, modify the permits, we don't think that we are going to need to build any new facilities in Idaho, that we will be able to repurpose existing facilities for storage that would cover all of the waste that we have, that we would project we would need through 2017. And at that time, we would be very close to completing our true waste mission. Right now, we're on track to retrieve and process all of the contact handled waste by 2018. And as I said, that's our primary goal. There are some other interim milestones or metrics within there, the settlement agreement that we need to meet that we're working with the state on. But the focus is to have all the true waste out of the state of Idaho by 2018. We know that that's going to be very challenging, but we will continue to work towards having all of the true waste certified for shipment by 2018. And we may work with Carlsbad and others as far as options that may help us actually get some waste out. But right now, that would be a very challenging thing to accomplish. Now, for the buried waste, we have a different milestone, but it's a much smaller quantity of material. But the deadline for the buried waste is 2023, and we are currently several years ahead of schedule on that, and that should not have any regulatory impacts.
Thank you.
706 shipments. That's an eye-opener and backlog. All right, let's hear from DOE's M&O contractor, Nuclear Waste Partnership, LLC. Phil Breidenbach, please, project manager.
So I'm glad to be here. I almost didn't make it. About 48 hours ago, when I was getting ready to leave, I figured out something didn't feel right, and I had food poisoning. And I could tell by the audience a few of you have had that at one point or another, and frankly, I was a mess, okay? So I left Carlsbad. I had that beautiful 2-hour and 15-minute drive. And I could tell you I've never had to stop before on that drive, but I stopped 4 times for various reasons. There aren't a lot of places to stop, by the way. There were basically no parts in my body that were working right, and no systems were on go. I got to the hotel, grabbed some medicine, which probably didn't help much, but at 5 o'clock in the afternoon, I collapsed into bed. I woke up at about 5 the next morning, thinking about I've got to get on an airplane, and it still wasn't good. So I went over, got on the plane, collapsed in a seat. I don't remember takeoff or landing into Atlanta. The guy next to me woke me up. But when I woke up in Atlanta, I felt a little better. And I got on the flight to D.C., and I kept feeling better and better. And as I was just thinking about this experience I just went through, I thought about, I am a living metaphor for WIPP. There were a lot of parts and pieces that weren't working at WIPP a year and a half ago, and I can tell you it's getting healthier and healthier, and it's going to make it, and we're going to start that place back up. I'll tell you a little bit about the status, where we stand, if I can figure out how to do this. There we go. Here are some of the major parts that I think are important to recovery. First, ground control. I'll always start with ground control. You know, 85% of the mine is recovered to the same way it was before the event happened. It's in a normal maintenance mode for ground control, and it will be like that essentially forever. 4,100 bolts have been installed. These are 8 to 12 foot long bolts that help secure that area. And those are done basically 7 days a week, around the clock, essentially. We've got 2 bolter crews working. We've got a third one that we just started up with a new piece of equipment called the hybrid bolter. It's important to us because, number one, it's brand new. It's got all of the safety equipment associated with it. Number two, it's hybrid. It runs off electricity, so it doesn't require additional ventilation. And it allows us to get another crew operating, so we've got 3 pieces of equipment operating at the same time. It's a big deal for us. Corrective actions, we all know about these AIB corrective actions. If you added them all up, there were 143 corrective actions that we needed to take. A month ago, 103 of those were complete, signed off by us, documented as complete. 2 weeks ago, it was 113. This week, it's 118. So we're making progress, significant progress, on closing out those corrective actions. The DSA, we all heard that was not where it needed to be. We're developing a new one. All of the chapters are in various stages of development or review. We last week looked at the first part of the TSR, had a team review through the first half of the TSR, had a great meeting, got great comments, operations, everyone that needed to be involved, DOE, DNFSB, lots of people involved, and we're making good progress in the DSA. We hope to deliver that approved document by the end of this year. Contamination mitigation. I came to WIPP out of the plutonium business. You know, I was one of those guys who made plutonium by the KG. And so I'm used to that kind of contamination, but I'm not used to it on essentially a dirt floor where you have dust. When you walk down in the mine and spend time down in the mine, sooner or later, or the underground, sooner or later, you'll end up tasting salt in your mouth, which isn't a bad thing unless there's contamination associated with that. So contamination control is a huge deal for us. We fix it by spraying water. Let the mine do, let the underground, the salt do what it's supposed to do. It ends up being entrained in the matrix and it becomes fixed. You don't want to run vehicles on top of that because it'll create dust again. So that's where we've put in new floors where we need to in the underground so that it's clean, so that we are prepared to actually transport drums to the places where it needs to go. We're doing system enhancements, ventilation. We're making good progress on the ventilation systems. They're all on site now, located on site, getting ready to place them on their pads that have been created and start essentially putting the pieces together on site to make them work. Fire detection systems, big deal for us, both on mobile equipment and fixed systems underground. We've got several that are in process of being installed and or being procured to be put in later this year and early next year. Rolling equipment, we backfit the first automatic fire system onto rolling equipment actually just last week, and we're going to be doing one or two of those a week from now until we're done. And then the last big piece, I think, is culture change. And we're doing that through a unrelenting focus on values, expectations, and standards. One of those values is accountability, and accountability comes in two flavors, both positive reinforcement for the things that we see, we want those behaviors to continue, and correction where that's needed. We're focused on timeouts, implementing timeout, use of timeout, stop work, critiques, lessons learned, and then we've implemented this thing called a leadership academy, which I think is going to end up being a best practice across all of DOE. This is a place where we take first-line managers for a month out of their life and train them about what it really means to lead a crew and what our values, expectations are and what's expected of them. And it's been going tremendously, actually. Really good. I would tell you, relative to accomplishments, as Frank said, closing the panel was a big deal. Isolating the drums from the workers was a significant risk reduction. We've had a couple chances, actually, relative to emergency response over the last couple months. One was actually, it was real, it was treated as real, it was later termed to be false, but the response of the crew, it provided a great opportunity for the entire emergency response organization, from the incident scene, people in the field, all the way up through our communications to external stakeholders, worked really well. And if you compare that to where we were a year and a half ago, that speaks for itself. The annual exercise also was conducted here a couple weeks ago, and although there were mistakes made during that, errors made by people, opportunities to learn, I call them. Overall, the response was good. It met our expectations, and we'll just learn from those and continue to improve our programs. Relative to radiological risk reduction, that's gone real well, as I've said. One of the things that I'd highlight here as an accomplishment is if you think about transuranics, and we had significant quantities of contamination, amounts of contamination through in various parts of the underground. And the idea that we had to deal with that relative to the dust that could be created. And when you think about our preparedness a year and a half ago with our radiological controls, the fact that we've gotten our people to be able to deal with that environment successfully, not had an uptake, not had a contamination event, not had a spread of contamination event over the last year is truly an accomplishment. Ground control, we've talked about. Use of corporate reachback, I think, was another tremendous accomplishment. I could ask, I'll take a chance. Who in the room, either their site or you personally, was involved in some aspect of WIPP recovery from the event through today? I mean, look at that. And I would tell you, as far as I know, there's only a couple people here from WIPP. So it really, truly was a complex effort there, and I appreciate the support that we've gotten from both AECOM and from the partner companies. And then lastly, all of this serves to rebuild trust. with the stakeholders. Lessons learned, couple lessons learned here real quick. I would tell you there's not a lot new here. Maybe I'll say it differently so it's more meaningful. One is that success leads to complacency. And for WIPP, that was what started as something that was really good, a motto that said, start clean, stay clean, which if I had been there in the beginning, I would have gotten behind. I would have jumped in with both feet. That was a great strategy. Until you let time go by, months, years, a decade, almost two, and the workforce and the management team and all of the people involved start to think that means we'll never see contamination here. And that leads you to start to look at, hey, do we really need all of these rad techs? Do we need all this training? Do we need all of these drills? Do we need all of this stuff? And pretty soon your margin starts to slowly slip away. That's what happened at WIPP. We can't let that happen again. It points to the second thing, which is the importance of clear standards. If you don't have clear standards, your standard becomes, I'll do the best I can with what I got, and that's not a standard. That's the road to failure. If the standards for maintenance are unclear, unknown, or not valued, then all of your money will get spent on what you do value, and it's typically going to be production. The nuclear versus mining culture is an interesting thing. You stand on the surface and talk to people, and people will say, those people in the underground need to realize this is a nuclear facility. And then you go in the underground, which I do a lot, talk to those guys, and they'll say, those people up there need to realize this is a mine. And the answer is it's both. And we all need to realize it's both. And there's hazards, special hazards associated with each, and we need to deal with every one of those hazards. Relative to recovery, I think one of the things that I would say is the team approach to workshops that we're using has been very successful. Safety basis, we've done a safety basis workshop, we've done a fire protection workshop, and we've got a startup workshop that's coming up later this month that are getting Defense Board, DOE, headquarters, contractor, all in the room at the same time to understand the standards, make sure we are in agreement on the expectations before we get too far into it. Clearly communicating funding needs is a priority for these kinds of things because you can't do it without funding. And then some contractors' ability to do nuclear work, we found, as many have, that we've got to put extra emphasis on our subcontractors to make sure that they perform the way that we need them to. The path forward for WIPP is simply develop and implement documented safety analysis, complete all of the accident investigation corrective actions, make all the pre-start modifications that are required, establish nuclear culture and conduct of operations, cold operations, and then we get to start it up. And all of those things are laid out, and we have a good plan, and we're making good progress on each. Understanding risks and assumptions is very important for us. Funding certainly will be a big deal. I think we've got a good handle on that. And then for each of the generators, one of the things that we'll be looking at is making sure that we don't have another drum that doesn't meet the standards for shipping to WIPP, and that's going to likely take the form of some form of generator qualification program, which we're working on. Thank you.
Thanks, Phil, for that update to supplement what Frank said earlier. So our last speaker, from a consent-based siting standpoint, I think you couldn't ask for a better host community. This is five decades long and running. So representing the city of Carlsbad, we have Dick Doss, who's the city council member. Dick.
Thank you. I've got a shot clock up here, and I think I can beat it. So a short history, because I see people out there who aren't as old as WIPP. A gentleman by the name of Senator Gant came into Carlsbad one day. He lived there, and he said there's a opportunity to put nuclear waste underground, and Kansas doesn't want it. So he called Congressman Muddy Reynolds, and he said, Mud, let's put this thing in Carlsbad. So he said, okay, let's do it. But the people are going to fight it. So we underwent a long, long period of education, arm twisting, and more education, and just said this can be done. It's a good thing. It's a positive use of the salt beds out east of town. It's in an area that is not being mined for potash, which is a component of both explosives, and it's also an agricultural product. But we had an area that we could mine in there. A number of years before that, there had been a nuclear bomb set off out there just to see what had happened. It was underground. There was minimal leak. It's very, very safe. I've sat on that spot and out quail hunting, and nothing happened. My children are normal. And finally, we got everybody in town to say, okay, fine, this is a good deal, and to help the DOE get it in. We had letter-writing campaigns. We invited them to town. We had parades through town. When they came in, they said, we've seen this before, but they were always anti. We said, well, we're welcoming you to town, but we want some things out of it. And part of it was we want to be involved. We would like to have some input into what's going on. And you need to change your culture, because at the time, DOE was probably known as the worst facility in government and had least confidence of any community that we could. We went around the communities, and they said, boy, if you want them in there, you're crazy. So we worked with them, and we built confidence, and we built respect between the two units. And we started working with the congressman, and we lobbied, and we worked with the government and the state. We had Bill Richardson against us when he was the representative, and then he was for us when he was the governor, and then he helped get open when he's in the Department of Energy, and now he's against us. And I will not take that any further. But I will say that our citizens support WIPP. We are all for it. We understand its mission. It's not just an economic development for Carlsbad, but is it a commitment to the nation to be a solution to the disposal of transuranic waste. And we want to stay active in that. Our workers have been in the salt mines all of their careers. And I say salt mines not that it's a bad thing, but it's potash mining out there. They know how to do mining in that salt. They know how to sink shafts. They know how to roof bolt. And they want to do it right. And right means safety, whether it be roof bolting, the decontamination, the transportation, or interim storage, which we have a site available about 17 miles from the WIPP site that is being developed right now in conjunction with Holtec. And we want to do it on budget, if we knew what that was. However, proper funding is essential. I have one way of getting that. Each of you sites who has a lot of waste and it wants to get rid of it, and get rid of it quickly, send us a check for 1% of your annual budget, and we can make this thing get open quickly. Part of the reason we need extra money there is the maintenance, and this is one of the things that Phil touched on, that the people got complacent down there. That mine is a salt mine. That salt is corrosive. It eats up stuff. Mr. Klaus says, we don't want to use 25-year-old technology down there. Well, we got 25-year-old machines down there, and that's one of the ones that caught on fire. And the maintenance on that was not adequate. And had we had the funding that we needed, it could have been taken care of. The delays due to funding are the most important, and funding the most important piece of the cleanup process, which is the last stop for the nuclear waste, is very frustrating. Please fund it so we can do it. We have a new manager, Todd Schrader. Welcome, Todd, wherever, if you're here. He has great credentials, and he'll be moving to Carlsbad shortly. We consider the management to be living in Carlsbad a very important function. It's an opportunity for him to make immediate decisions, provided he's given the authority and that he has quick access to top management. He will also have the pulse of the community. It will be good, it will be honest, and he may or may not like it, but he's going to hear it. He'll hear it at the grocery store, and he'll hear it at the football games. When this started, the community was promised direct access to the Secretary of Energy, and that the local field office manager would be able to make decisions on the spot. It worked. And then, as Phil indicated, everybody got complacent, and I think part of it deteriorated. We think it's getting better again, but both sides need to work on it. DOE and the community. We have a mayor's task force led by John Heaton that meets weekly. We have a community meeting monthly at City Hall. We have state officials, DOE officials, not only local, but come in from D.C. Frank's been there, probably had enough, but he's been there. Monica's been there. And for those people that can't attend, we stream it so that they can watch it. Dr. Regla-Buto said she is in favor of local decision-making, and these meetings provide the opportunity for the community to express our desires. Again, we want to be part of the nuclear solution. We were promised some community benefits. Part of that had to do with purchasing locally, sales of equipment and supplies, and now the goal appears to be to purchase centrally through Cincinnati. That money does not circulate locally. Those people don't have the supplies on hand in Carlsbad when they're needed. And when they're needed in the middle of the night, they don't deliver. The people who work and sell items in Carlsbad do. It's just good business. The host communities make the whole complex work. Communities like Aitken, Hartford, Los Alamos, and the others need WIPP, and WIPP needs them. When it's all cleaned up, the communities need help. We need to transition into private industry, and we'll need help doing it. There's a good roadmap out there. It's called the Blue Ribbon Commission Report, and if we'll use it, it'll be beneficial to all of us. So let's all work together. And Carlsbad says, we want your waste.
Thanks, Dick, for those open and honest comments. Have you thought about running for president? All right, it's time for... We have about 8 to 10 minutes for questions. I would like you to use a mic and state your name and affiliation. Since I have a mic in front of me, I'm dying to ask a question. So what I heard from Jack was 706 shipments of waste and backlog. If I go back to my WIPP days and a nameplate capacity, that's about a half a year of shipments sitting waiting to go. So with the interim ventilation system and the supplemental ventilation system up and running sometime next year, I didn't hear anyone talk about what your projected shipment rate is likely to be under that scenario under limited ops. So Frank or Phil, can you give us an idea of how much?
I can tell you what was in the budget request. Up to five shipments, at least initially.
Five shipments a week?
Yep.
So 260 a year until you get up to the permanent vent system. Okay.
Yeah, and our thought was that it would start slow and then ramp up. There's some, you know, we got to see how that goes. The conditions have changed in the mine, obviously, and so that has to change our procedures. 10 shipments a week is what we thought we may be able to get to with the existing, but then it will have to go to, in order to get any past that. The thought is we need permanent ventilation.
Good. Thanks very much. From the floor, Mr. Fiore from the back of the room. There we go.
Got it. Very on. Question concerns deferred maintenance, and I guess it's a two-parter, one for Phil on the site-specific condition. Was it a case of your system just not being adhered to and a little bit of complacency on the implementation of it, or was it really more of perhaps the whole system needed to be changed or improved? And the second one kind of relates that, or relates to Frank dealing with that, maybe on the EM-wide thing. With respect to deferred maintenance, any specific things that EM's doing across the board other than saying you got to do better funding it and do a better job on deferred maintenance? Any specifics out of Frank? So if we could do Phil first and then Frank.
Yeah, from what I've seen at WIPP, I think it's both. Relative to your first question, I think there are examples where systems had reached end of life, so maintenance was becoming more and more difficult, more and more costly, and therefore replacement was the right choice, and that wasn't done, and then that put strain on the system to be able to maintain the other systems. Per normal PM programs that you would expect to see in place, which makes those systems age faster, and it ends up all being a vicious cycle that you end up getting sucked into.
Well, and what we have now, and you know, Bill and his folks have provided, we've got a list of maintenance items that need to be attended to, and I think they're starting to be given more attention in the budget cycle as well. I know we were up briefing the appropriators recently, and it was a big topic of discussion with those folks. So I think it's getting more attention, I think there seems to be a willingness to put more money towards these items as well from the appropriations.
I would give DOE credit. The shift has started. Really, it started prior to the event. It just happened a little late. Where they started to incentivize replacement of systems and improvement of PM programs and maintenance programs for the systems, and that's continuing today. For example, part of our incentive program for this year was to reduce the PM backlog substantially, which we accomplished. So that will continue through the next PEMP and through the next years.
PM is in preventive maintenance, I assume.
Yes, yes, okay. That's what I'm talking about. Apologize.
Other questions, please. Right here, and then we'll go here next. So we'll have Mr. Heaton second, if that's all right.
This goes to Phil and Dick Dawson. I know each other back during the parade days with Leo Duffy. We walked that through. Phil, there was a call out a couple of years ago, just before the last continuing resolution, to all the sites on their aging infrastructure. Yep. WIPP was one of them.
Yep.
All that depended on funding. It was a shortfall. That shortfall impacted WIPP as well. At Savannah River, Hanford, Oak Ridge, they all felt the impact. The incident that occurred out there, maybe part of it had to do with the aging infrastructure, but it wasn't the total fault. We know that. My question goes with Dick Dots. He says he has an interim storage location. The estimate was put out in print that they estimated the recovery for WIPP would be about $500 million. But what's not included in that, and Frank knows this, is the estimated cost, which hasn't been derived yet, for the delay of shipments for true waste that are being pushed into temporary storage at Savannah River, Hanford, Idaho, Oak Ridge, other sites. What's the cost projection on that? And if we could get away from that interim storage or delay storage, some of it going to waste control specialists in Texas, it might help the program that Dick Doss is trying to emphasize on.
I'm going to defer this to John Heaton because John's the head of the ALEA project, which is where that site is, and has entered into a contract with Holtec to get it started. So, John, if you'd like to give a little background on that.
So, John, you get to answer the question and ask your own question.
You get to answer it and then ask. Anyway, I'm John Heaton, and the ALEA proposed interim storage facility is one particularly for spent nuclear fuel. And it is, as you know, to get a facility licensed, it will take us probably 3 years to get that facility licensed after we've submitted the license application. So we don't expect to be open till 2020. So in the interim, there's really no place to go. Possibly there is a true storage facility at WCS, I believe, that has some capability of doing that. But whether or not DOE wants to make that decision to pay them, they're already paying them $5 million a year for the few drums that they did ship there and that they can't remove, they can't put them on the road. So because they don't meet DOT standards to get put on the road, so it's kind of a conundrum as far as that goes. So I'm not sure what that decision would be made. But this is in particular designed for spent fuel. And obviously we'd like to get into spent fuel or high-level waste storage as well if that becomes an interest of DOE in the future. So that's my answer to that. Then as far as a question goes, we feel in Carlsbad very nationalistic about WIPP as Dick, and I'd like to comment a little bit on Mark's introductory comments as well as Dick. One of the issues that we have as a community is that we keep looking into the future. We have 16 square miles of bedded salt and the capability of enormous amounts of storage or disposal in that salt. And so we want to talk about issues related to the future in the community, knowing all of you know what the long lead times are for anything that's nuclear. It's sometimes decades. And so we would like, as Mark mentioned in his opening comments about WIPP having great potential for defense high-level waste, for defense spent fuel, some of those sorts of things, we would like to continue those discussions. Prior to the incident, we were having those discussions and we were very involved in those discussions. And now since the incident has occurred, all we hear from DOE is don't say anything about anything else. We are fully convinced that WIPP will reopen. It'll reopen within a reasonably short period of time. And there's no question about that. I have every confidence that will happen. But we want to talk about the future and what could potentially be available for WIPP as we go forward. So maybe, how do we bridge this, Frank, Christine? How do we bridge this block that we have at headquarters about talking about the future of WIPP? And then the second question I have that I don't know who wants to answer is that we have at WIPP what's called a difficult waste stream group that goes out and looks at the documentation for all the waste streams prior to coming to WIPP. And they look at those waste streams and they decide whether they're difficult or not. If they are difficult, then they prescribe the treatment process. The issue here is who was looking at the treatment process? And so my next question is, how are we going to have some assurance that we don't get sent junk again that's going to cause a problem, that's going to be a $500,000, 3 or 4 year delay for all of you at your sites? So I would like to ask that question as well.
Frank had to take a really important phone call, so he's not here to answer the first question. You're talking about the true program system impacts of not shipping at the generator and storage sites?
Mark, let me ask Jack a question. Jack's got one site with Idaho. Can Jack tell us, based on his storage, temporary facilities, et cetera, and delays on the waste factor that's on the WIPP, is that projected figure by the month, by the year, the rate?
Okay. So if we can get a short answer to that, we ought to get back to Mr. Heaton.
But
so,
as far as the exact numbers, you know, I don't have those exact numbers. The immediate impact is essentially negligible. We were repurposing existing facilities that we already had to maintain. They already had other uses. We're reconfiguring storage for, you know, greater density, more stacking. The real impact is going to come after 2019. If we haven't emptied those facilities out by that time, I mean, a lot of those facilities should have been emptied. They would have been starting into the D&D process, but we will have to continue to maintain the infrastructure and support. And, if it goes beyond 2019. If we find a, right now, we're hoping that they will give us a site to ship that material to. But the bottom line is that the immediate impacts are very small. The long-term, the out-year impacts, if we don't get to shipping at a fairly high rate, are going to be very significant. And I don't have that number off the top of my head, but I would guess it's $10 to $20 million a year after 2019.
For one. Site.
Yeah, but we have the most material. I don't know about the other sites. They have much smaller quantities of material.
I think an answer to your question would be when the FY17 budget rolls out next February, you would have an updated life cycle cost number at the site level and at the program level, and that would be the kind of thing reflected in there.
I hate to do this, especially to one of my members. I think we have to get back to John's question probably on the side. Frank, you owe me. Anyway, we're just running out of time, and I think we have to go to the break. So I just want to please join me in thanking this panel. This is a very interesting panel.